Good evening and welcome to the City Council Candidates Forum, sponsored by the League of Women Voters of Wichita Falls. I'm Penny Miller and I'm the president of the local league. And one of the things that the League of Women Voters most likes to do is to make sure that all of our citizens participate in the democratic process by going to vote. And of course, we want you to be informed about the candidates and the issues so that when you go, you can cast the best informed vote that you can. Before we get started this evening, I just want to bring up a couple things. Number one, cell phones. Please silence those little puppies so it doesn't disrupt the questions and the responses. And secondly, one of the services we provide is the Voter's Guide. If you didn't pick up a Voter's Guide on your way in, they are available on the table out in the hall. And this is a good resource to get more information on the candidates and their responses to various questions. It also tells you where you can vote. And we also have a pro and con on the WFISD bond. So be sure you do that. For those of you who are not here this evening but are watching on the recast, then you can get those online or several places around the city library, Luby's, and another number of other places. So I'm going to turn this over to Kay Holland. Kay is going to be our moderator for this evening and will be asking the questions of the candidates.
Larry has already explained the cards to the candidates, but we will do that again.
All right. Okay, I'll be up here. I'll do it from here. Okay. First of all, we'd like to introduce our candidates from left to right. Counselor at Large, Michael Smith and Crystal James. Counselor District 1, Stephen Santana and Walter King. And District 2, Donnie Milton and DeAndre Chenault. Thank you all. Now, each candidate will have 3 minutes to explain why you're running, a little bit about yourself, and anything else that you want to say. And at that point, Larry will hold up the card to tell you when your time is up. Okay, so we will go from left to right, and we're going to start with Mr. Smith.
Good evening. Welcome to everyone to this candidates forum. I'd like to just review a little bit of my history. I've lived in Wichita Falls almost all my life. I went through the school system here, graduated from Wichita Falls High School, earned my bachelor's and master's from Midwestern State University, and then I was teacher, principal, and superintendent at City View ISD for 37 years, retired in 07, ran for city council, and have served various positions since that time. I think my background and experience in education set me really well for serving as a city council person. Many of the situations are similar. Lots of phone calls, lots of people who may not be as happy as they could be. And dealing with people like that, you learn to see their point of view and have empathy for their situation, whatever it might be. Had a lot of experience with finance, with governmental rules, and of course dealing with people. And that did set me up very well for being a council person. And in the 8 years I've been on the council, I've of course learned lots about state government, its relationship to municipalities throughout the state, and just how the system works. And it always takes a certain amount of time to learn any system when you're new to it. I've certainly enjoyed my time on the council. I have again learned so much and feel like my background now in public school education and city government has led me to this election, and I ask for your vote. I hope everyone votes either in early voting this week and next week, and on Election Day, Saturday, May 9th.
Ms. James?
Hello, my name is Crystal James, and I'm running against Mr. Smith for the at-large position. I've lived in Wichita Falls for about 15 years, and when I first got here, I remember thinking, it's wonderful to be in the great state of, historic state of Texas, and that Wichita Falls is such a great place to live and to raise a family. And despite our drought and our tough economic times, I think it's still a great place to live. And it's been a wonderful 15 years, and I really love Wichita Falls. I'm currently a realtor, so I deal with a lot of people, and I have learned in my dealings with people how to negotiate and how to listen. And I'd like to bring all of those skills to the city council and listen to the voters. Oftentimes I hear from people who feel like the city council hasn't listened to them. And I think that's something that needs to be addressed. I've also dealt with many organizations in my time living in Wichita Falls, Girl Scouts, 4-H, my church, Toastmasters, and Friends of the Library, just to name a few. And I really enjoy serving the public, and I would love to have the opportunity to serve the entire city as your counselor at large. My platform is securing and increasing our water supply, ensuring our future growth and economic development, and making the local government accessible and making sure people feel like they're heard. I think it's important that we have a good supply of water and that we continue with our water conservation. Currently, Wichita Falls is a leader in water conservation and reuse, and we need to keep up that culture and bring it forward into the future. We also need to think about growth, because economic growth means opportunity for everyone. Texas's population is estimated to grow over the next 45 years to almost double, and millennials are going to be half the workforce by the next 5 years. So we need to make sure that our city is a place that millennials want to live and to work. And I'd love to see some more walkable neighborhoods, things that people would like to live near, and have the idea of Wichita Falls being such a great place to live just like I do.
Mr. Santillana?
Well, first of all, I want to thank everybody. Thank the League of Women Voters for putting this on. This is a great and wonderful thing you do for the constituents out here. The information is needed, and Larry and everybody here, y'all do a wonderful job. And for the City of Wichita Falls for letting their use their facilities. My name is Steven Santillana. I was born and raised in the area. Did my education in Holiday High School with a little bit at here in Wichita Falls Elementary. I'm a graduate of Western State University, graduated with a double major in political science and criminal justice. I raised my family here. My wife Jessica works out of Shepherd Air Force Base. I have three kids, Austin, Campbell, and Court. They all three go to school at Christ Academy, where I serve on the school board. In town, I own and operate two businesses. One's a business that deals with highway construction, and we do highway contracts for the state of Texas. And we have another sales and manufacturing company that sells manufacturing for those contracts. My involvement with the community started the day I graduated. I wanted to be community involved. I love our community. Wichita Falls is a great city, and we live in a great state. From the day I graduated, I wanted to do something. I joined, was able to be on the Leadership Wichita Falls graduation class of 2003, and the following year I joined the board. I stayed on that board until we started having children. Then I took a brief stint off, and then from there we went on to Crime Stoppers, which I served 6 years. Really opened my eyes to our community. Had the opportunity to work with officers for the last 6 years. I'm rolling off this year. I've also been on the Association of General Contractors, where I serve as the area vice chairman. That's a very powerful organization that we have. All of these things that I've done for the community, the passion that I have for community, coupled with the businesses that I run, I think give me the ability to be a good counselor. Day in and day out, I'm responsible for 80 plus employees, 14 different job sites, and I still take the time out for our community. I've done that because I have a passion for community. I'm relentless in that, and that I want to be part of this community. I don't want to be a passive member of our community. I want to be active. And it doesn't pay well. I tell people that all the time. When you're on a board, it doesn't pay very well at all. And League of Women Voters, you know this. Y'all give your time, and you realize real quick that you have to have a passion for what you're doing. This to me is the next natural step that I wanted to take. I wanted to be directly involved with the city and the functions and the decisions that we make. I think that City of Wichita Falls is going in a good direction. We really are. I think people look at us with our drought situation and they think that, you know, maybe City of Wichita Falls, you know, economically and with their drought are not doing well, but I tell people we're growing in a positive direction and we're doing well. So I think with my business sense, I think with my education, and I think with my community involvement, I'll help to earn everybody's vote. Thank you.
Mr. King.
My name is Walter King. I'm running for this position because I want to be the voice of my many neighbors that don't always feel their concerns are being addressed at City Hall. I have sat in on many council meetings over the years. I've tried to attend every one of them. I think there's no better way to learn city government than to be there to look, listen, understand, and learn. I have watched all these council meetings and I've addressed a few of them. The first council meeting I addressed, I asked on tax increases. I said, is there another way? The answer I got was no. Well, I know there's another way now. We can manage our money a little better than what we've been doing. We have all agree on the same issues, the water, the budget, unemployment. The citizens of Wichita Falls have just done a tremendous job of conserving the water and that we have. And there's nothing higher on the list of priorities for city staff. As far as unemployment, yes, we need big business, but we need these small businesses too. The men and women that built Wichita Falls were wearing work clothes, not suit and ties. On the budget, we need to address priorities and eliminate the waste. We need to keep our city on sound financial ground. We need to ensure our current city services are maintained at a very high level, but I believe in getting my neighbors good values for their tax dollars. I'm retired. I graduated Ohio in 1965, 50 years ago. We're having our 50-year reunion this year. I joined the Marine Corps. I came back home. I went to work for AT&T for 33 years, then 11 years for National Linen before they closed their plant. If I am elected to this position, I plan on being out at some place like Market Street or Brahms, having a cup of coffee, being available for my neighbors to give me their concerns at least 2 or 3 days a week. Sometimes the best help you can be is just to be a good listener. I love Wichita Falls, and I do not want to be priced out of my home by ever increasing taxes every other year. The foundation of our democracy is to ensure that every voice is heard. and the ultimate choice lies in yours, the voters' hands. Please study every candidate and vote to the one you think will serve your district best.
Thank you. Mr. Melton.
Yes, ma'am.
But I've lived in District 2 for 51 years. One of the grandest districts there is in Wichita Falls, as far as I'm concerned. I have had my businesses in District 2 for 41 years. I have had several businesses here in town, enjoyed working in the business community, enjoyed working with the city of Wichita Falls. I've been active in a bunch of city council meetings with the businesses that I have been in. I know some about the business of the city council. They've got a hard job to do. Sometimes not a real popular job. I think everybody up here knows that whoever gets it's not going to have a real popular position sometimes. I have loved District 2 ever since I've been here. I've done a lot of a community to work with children mainly. I like to do benefits for the children, like the Children's Home Benefit that used to be out of Outskirts. We started it, and the Children's Home got quite a bit of stuff repaired and fixed, and the new gymnasium, everything through the benefit. When it comes to the children of Wichita Falls, that's our natural resources that we're supposed to be taking care of, and the Lord gave us them to take care of. District 2 has been very good to me, and if I do get elected to the council, I do want to take care of each and every member of District 2. I want to be a voice for District 2. I don't want to be somebody that's got special interest groups to do, but my three issues is economic growth. District 2 needs quite a bit of growth in the district, and I would love to help to work this out with everybody. The east side, we need grocery stores over there. We need grocery stores throughout District 2 because we don't have the grocery store like we have on the other side of town. And I think if we can get the right people together, we can bring economic growth back to it and bring businesses back to it. I would love to see a friendlier city with the public and the city staff. I think the city works hard, but I think that the community also works hard, and if we could work together, we could eliminate some of the problems that we have between us. And then our water is, you know, our main concern, and I think the city has done a good job, and so has the citizens of Wichita Falls. I thank you very much.
Okay. Ms. Chenault.
Good evening. My name is Deandra M. Chenault, and I'm running for City Council for District 2. The reason I'm running for City Council, I want to be more involved in my community. I want to make a positive change. What better way to make a change than to become a change maker? My platform consists of drought. We do know that it profoundly affects the industries, jobs, and growth in Wichita Falls. Our city leaders and engineers are doing everything and anything possible to find ways to improve our water situation now and in the future. My next point is taxes. The mention of this word evokes concern and questions. There is a concern when there is a talk about taxes going up. I want to make sure that the residents of Wichita Falls are getting all the services that they pay for. My other concern is neighborhood restoration. Everything starts with beautification. Physical improvements lead to economic and social improvements. No one can do this for us. It has to start with us, the residents. I also want to restore safety to our neighborhoods. We want our neighborhoods to be a safe place to live, play, and work. I also desire to restore the duties of citizenship and residence. Voting is a duty. All of the eligible citizens of Wichita Falls. And some of the things that I would like to accomplish is a grocery store, a gas station, a post office box, and a drive-up ATM. I am from Wichita Falls, Texas, born and raised. I graduated from Wichita Falls High School. I went on to further my education at Jarvis Christian College, where I received a bachelor's degree in criminal justice. And remember, no vote, no voice, vote Chenault.
Okay, thank you, thank you. All right, we've all mentioned water. Water is an issue. So right now, I'm going to ask one question. Each of you will get 2 minutes to answer the question, okay? Larry will hold up the cards. Everybody has commented on the seriousness of the water situation here in Wichita Falls, in both the Times Record News and in the voter guide. Do you as a candidate have any specific recommendations or measures that have not already been considered or proposed? Please answer the question. Mr. Smith?
Well, being on the City Council, of course, as the public has seen, we have looked at every possible viable way to gain more water and conserve what we have. And of course, the citizens have done such a wonderful job in conserving that has saved us many, many hundreds of millions of gallons of water. Other than what we have looked at, and again, what the public has seen, there are scientific breakthroughs out there that have not really been discussed, and I would like to look at some of those as we continue to go through this drought. There are desalination plants that have never been built but have been looked at, and the thing with them is they're very energy costly. They provide water, and of course the source that you would look at typically would be the oceans. Now that's a problem for us in Wichita Falls. We're so far inland, but that's on the board in my vision, that as droughts come and go, and maybe as climate change has dictated, some of these droughts will get to the point that we have to look at that last source of water, which is salt water, but that can be run through a desalination plant. Conservation, I think, has not been looked at as much as it could be. There are still things that can be done. They're costly. All of us as users of water will have to pay for that, but conservation is there. We must revisit that on an ongoing basis.
All right. Thank you. Ms. James.
I have read through the long-term water plan, and it's pretty extensive and goes over a lot of different ideas. I think the city's already on track with probably some of the best plans that there are in there. As far as any ideas that haven't been mentioned or aren't in any other format, maybe a rain dance. We could have the world's largest rain dance. That would be great. Maybe make it into a rain festival. We could bring in some economic dollars, some tourist dollars, hopefully play in the mud a little bit. But other than desalinization, which is a really great idea, although highly expensive, I think maybe some stimulus from the city government on ways to allow individuals to harvest rainwater, such as rain barrels, and a program maybe that would allow citizens to collect more of the stuff that falls from the skies.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Santayana.
Well, I agree with Councilor Smith. I think at this point we've exhausted about everything we can afford at this point. I mean, with a big hefty pot of money, there's, you know, sky's the limit, but we're restricted to funds that we have available. Idea-wise, I know that the councilors and our city leadership have explored other things. We've looked at some drilling issues. I think West Texas, they've done some things. Some people have come here and looked at that. You can maybe further restrict water. Maybe some business can get some further restriction. I know that's kind of a big no-no subject, but you know, if you get to that point where we're wanting to do something or one thing or the other, I think maybe that can do, you know, maybe restrict, but that doesn't bring any more water in. Pray for rain. I mean, it's like you see the signs around town. I fully believe in that. I mean, get together in your community, get in your church. We say in our church every Sunday. I mean, a quick prayer for rain. Other than that, I mean, I think sometimes you can probably look to other leadership within our city, coupled with the leadership that we have already, maybe form a committee or some kind of think tank that can start brainstorming some really progressive ideas towards bringing water in. But, you know, Councilor Smith put it well, I think, in his response in the paper, that there's just, we've done what we can. I think the citizens have done their part. I think the city's done their part. I think the council has done its part. We have some great individuals that have done their part. As far as water issues, maybe a little bit better with the marketing. You know, the toilet to tap maybe wasn't the greatest thing, but, you know, I think maybe we could maybe done a better job with that. That's still not going to bring water in. What's going to bring water in is rain. Today was a glorious day. We had 1.75 fall in our town and not so much in our watershed, but that's what's really going to help the situation. But I think just anything else, if you're passionate and relentless in that striving for trying to find a solution, I think we can probably find some better solutions. But with anything, it's just going to take money. It's going to take money and time for people to start developing the ideas. Even the ideas that we've implemented now weren't overnight. It took time. We never thought we were going to be in this drought situation, but we're here. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. King.
On the water issue, I think Michael was listening that day when they brought that report back on all the far-reaching places that we might be able to get water from, and none of them were viable. And 2 years ago, I talked to the man that sits here, Mr. Barnum, about the Wichita River over here. And he said at that time, well, it's just too polluted. Well, now I think it's being considered now to use the Wichita River right over here off of Beverly behind Tanglewood, bring that water to the water plant. But that's going to really tear up our reverse osmosis filters because it is so polluted. It's going to shorten the lifespan. I think it's 7 years on the filters now, and they're due to be changed in the next year or two. This would probably cut the lifespan of the filters in half, but that is a source of water. I see the water running down that river every day for 50 years. Thank you.
Okay. Mr. Milton.
I know it sounds like a recording, but Mr. Smith hit it on the head. We've got people conserving the water, and they're doing a great job. The city has done a tremendous job with everything they've done. I would like to see the citizens take it on themselves for their water into their yards and stuff to get these water containers and reclaim water from their roofs and stuff to do the water instead of using city water, even the water that they go out and buy that's basically considered wastewater. A lot of people starting to put tanks in, and I think with more people doing tanks, they're doing more with water. That's like Holiday school system. They just got through digging that big tank over the Holiday so they can water all their grounds now without having to use any kind of water from the city or anything else. So I think people doing some tanks, some of these little tanks from the drainage of the roofs. People keep trying to find new ways to conserve. Every day there's somebody coming up with a new idea, and I was here the day that they was talking about all the choices we had, and every choice would jump up $150,000, $200,000, $300,000, $400,000. Yeah. And, you know, it just, we're just going to have to all get together and conserve a little bit better. And I know everybody's conserved, but we're just going to have to just dig down and do our best, and also try to reclaim water ourselves to reuse. And I think the reverse osmosis has helped us considerable. Thank you.
All right. Ms. Chenault.
I believe our city leaders and engineers have done everything and anything possible to find ways to improve the water situation now and in the future. And us as citizens have gone far and beyond what has been requested to conserve water.
Okay, thank you. Now then, our first questions will go for the district at large candidates. And you have, I will ask a question to the candidate, and then the opposing candidate has 1 minute for a rebuttal. So it'll be 2 minutes, and then a rebuttal, and then we'll go back and forth. Okay, just at large. Mr. Smith, you have stated in both the Times Record News and the Voter Guide that you would like to have competitive salaries and benefits for city employees. How would you accomplish that without raising taxes?
The salary schedule in Wichita Falls, the city of Wichita Falls, is looked at on a regular basis. We have a comparison with 15 other like-sized cities in the state of Texas, and we've tried to keep at the middle of that range of salaries in these sister cities of ours. It's very difficult, and has been very difficult in the last few years with the Great Recession, to continue to stay in the middle of that salary range. And salary is an important part of anyone's vision for the future as an individual. And we have lost firemen, police officers, computer technicians, community planning people, and folks from almost every department in the city of Wichita Falls organization. Now, the difficult part is, where do you get the money? You know, over any period of time, you have inflation. And there's always a desire to keep up with inflation as a consumer or as an entity that has people working for them. Every year when we look at budget, and I did this also in public education, you have to look at where your money's coming from and where it's being spent. The tax increase side of this equation is always very difficult. The way we would hope to continue to address it, that I would hope to continue to address it, would be realistic. You have to deal with inflation, but be of a mindset that you have to not have a tax increase that is very difficult for the taxpayers.
All right. Ms. James, rebuttal.
Without raising taxes is pretty difficult. I agree. Perhaps looking at duplication of jobs and making sure that there isn't money being spent in places that it shouldn't be spent, making sure to audit and plan ahead, be sure that you'll be able to increase in a couple of years, making sure that there's not waste anywhere else in your budget, and trimming away anything that really shouldn't be spent on.
Okay. All right, Ms. James, this is for you. In the Times Record News, you said that the drought issues have been a major problem in the Wichita Falls real estate market. Do you have any other proposals that you believe that would help that market?
We need to make sure to keep our neighborhoods places that people want to live, such as District 2 and District 1. Those neighborhoods need amenities that people are going to find desirable. So schools, parks, neighborhood shopping, areas for children to play, safety, communities that people would want to live in is really how to keep a neighborhood viable. New construction often keeps its price longer than a home that may be 80 or even 30 years old. But applying these same principles to all neighborhoods would help in making them places that people want to live regardless of the drought situation.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Smith, a criticism has been made that there is not... Oh, that's what I was supposed to say, was rebuttal.
One minute.
Yes.
You know, there's something called quality of life. And each neighborhood has its own distinct characteristics. But I think from a city council view, we look at the city as a whole with input from each councilor, each neighborhood, each district, and the citizens that live there. And the goal of the city council, and it's been my goal over the past 8 years, is to look at things that we need to do in the city to improve this quality of life. We have built a brand new airport terminal. We have built a what I call a bus station. It's called the Travel Center, that provided a service that we did not even have here in Wichita Falls at the time. That's quality of life for those who do not drive, those who can't drive. The trail system that we are fixing to finish is great for quality of life.
Thank you, and I apologize for jumping ahead there. Now then, the question goes back to Mr. Smith. A criticism has been that there is not enough transparency in the workings of the city government. As one who has worked on the council, how would you rate the transparency of the city as it is now?
I think the transparency, as it's called, is excellent. I sit on the council and have for 8 years, and I've seen many issues come forward. I've seen the way they've been handled, and then I've seen the way that that has been sent back out to the public. All of our council meetings, we have two meetings a month, are open to the public. They are televised live at that time, twice a month, and then they're replayed throughout the month. The TV channel that the city has for its operation has many, many different shows on what is going on in city government, what each department is doing, new things on the horizon. When we talk budget, there's all kinds of media on that. And go online, we have streaming video of everything we do. The transparency, as it's called, is there. And it's up to the citizens, though, to make themselves available to that, to look, to listen, to read what their city is doing. You know, the city of Wichita Falls and its government is the citizens. But you must participate. You must make yourself knowledgeable about what the city's doing. So I think what we do as a city government reflects the citizens. And for them, it must be a situation where you keep up with it. You know, many times there's rumors, there's urban legends, I don't know what all you do call them, but you need to find out what that's really about. And it's there for you to find out.
Thank you. Ms. James, rebuttal.
Government transparency, it's always a hot topic because there's always people who seem to know and those who don't seem to know. And from what I have seen in running and speaking with many members of the city government, the transparency is there. And Mr. Smith is right. You really have to get out there and be part of it and participate. That way you know what's going on. It isn't designed in such a fashion at the moment to reach out and just grab you. You have to go out and grab it instead.
All right, thank you. Now, Ms. James, this question is for you. In the voter guide, you stated that one of the goals of the city council should be to make local government more accessible to the public. How would you go about making city government more accessible than it is now?
Good question. The city has an app, and unfortunately, it doesn't work very well at the moment. I'd love to see that app working better. Then you could get information right on your phone. Other aspects of the city government that I'd like to see is the water department has a hard time telling people when they're going to shut off their water. Not just people, but in businesses as well. I'd love to see them communicate better with the public. And I'd love to be able to see the public communicating on maybe something like a crowdsourcing project to crowdsource not only ideas for solutions to problems, but also the problems that people see. And maybe that way people feel like they have more of that accessibility to that transparency and really feel like they're participating in part of what's going on.
All right, thank you. Mr. Smith, rebuttal?
There is a need, and we have talked about it, and I've tried to kind of crusade for it a little bit. I think there is a need for regular, I don't know what frequency, but regular night meetings. City council meetings that are held at night are at least late enough in the day that the working person can attend. That is something that has not happened since I've been on the council. And what we have done is we've had town hall meetings, and those are successful, but it seems like the attendance is not what you'd like. You'd like to see, you know, if it's a town hall meeting for a particular area of town, and that's how we've handled them in the past, you would hope there would be not just dozens and dozens of people, but hundreds of people. So I'd like to see that happen a little bit more in the future, and I would look for increased attendance to those.
All right. Okay, now we're going to go to District 1. So, Mr. Santiano, in the voter guide, you stated that planning for our deteriorating infrastructure is a major issue of the future. What would be among your highest priorities for these improvements, and how would they be funded?
Well, funding is the big issue. Right now, there's not a huge concern on the deteriorating infrastructure because we have our minds on our drought situation. We have our minds on economic growth. I listed those just about like everybody else up here. You know, those are our top two things we want in this, something that we need to see for our city. The things we don't see are the things that are underground. I bring them to light because that's what I do for a living. We work in cities and we work in counties where we see deteriorated infrastructure. You have highways, you have water systems, you have sewer systems, stormwater systems that are old. And sometimes it's passing the buck to the next guy, the next city planner, the next council, the next mayor. If you can get by with patching it, you could do that for a while. When I say a while, I'm talking about 50, 60 years. At some point, your old clay sewer lines, your old copper lines, your old water lines deteriorate, and they burst. We started seeing that when we started hitting the drought. There was a lot of shifting. We start seeing that when we have a change of seasons. We know here in Wichita Falls, you're 30 degrees one day and you're 85 the next. We have an infrastructure deteriorating. There needs to be a hard look at that. I mean, right now that's something that has to be put on the back page because of our drought situation. Funding it is tough. I mean, we have a budget. We have a budget for that infrastructure. We do as many roads as we can right now. It's tough to pull money out of anything else and put it towards that budget right now, but when making that statement, it was something more of a future need that I think we're going to have. I think we're going to look at our highway systems that the city has to maintain. The ones that are federally maintained, the state maintained, are great. The budgets for those are going to double over the next couple of years. We're going to be sitting in a good situation in our county and in our city with the money that we're getting from the federal government. We have a project coming up right now on Southwest Parkway where you take the big ditch and they're actually going to make that into a turning lane that ends up going into the McNeil project the city is funding. But with the deteriorating infrastructure, I think what you really do is you have to take a hard look at what we can do in the future by making planning situations today.
All right, thank you. Mr. King, rebuttal.
Some of the infrastructure that he's not thinking about, you've got your little sewer lines, your little water lines, but you've also got the main water line coming from Lake Kickapoo to Wichita Falls. It's over 50 years old, so is the pump station. Arrowhead is 45 years old and the pump station. These are going to be super jobs. That's where your money is going to go for your infrastructure for the next few years. And I've got to say, while I've got my 2 minutes or my 1 minute, if you call a police officer and a water line repair crew, the water line repair crew will beat you to the leak. They do such a wonderful job.
All right, thank you. Mr. King, in the Times Record News, you suggested that the health department include a rating of A, B, and C that would be posted in the front of the restaurants based on kitchen inspections. Could you expand on this idea, and do you know of other cities that are using this method?
I did not hear the last part of the question.
Okay.
I'm sorry.
You got the ABC.
ABC
thing.
Yes, ma'am.
All right. Would you expand on the idea of the rating system, and do you know any other cities that use that now?
Yes, ma'am. A lot of cities in California, New York, New Jersey, Colorado, Arizona, New Mexico. What it is a red letter, A, B, or C, depending on the score of the kitchen. This will do two things. It will tell the people that are going to eat in that restaurant what kind of kitchen they got. It will also force the restaurant to do a better job of keeping their kitchen clean and sanitary conditions, because nobody wants to see a B or C on their door. That's why.
Okay. Mr. Santiana?
I'm not sure that it's the best idea that we have in rating our restaurants. I used to own a restaurant. That was my first business out of college, was owning a restaurant. I know from restaurant staff that you have good days and you have bad days. You have more good days than you do have bad days, but every now and then you can have a bad day. But we have a health department that deals with that already. I'm not sure how rating A, B, and C on the outside of a restaurant helps build businesses in Wichita Falls. I don't think we want to project that out there to the public or to any other restaurant. You know, right now, we talk about it all the time. The businesses that we do have coming right now is restaurants. Wichita Falls is full of restaurants, and we get new restaurants all the time. I don't want to project that out there that we don't want you to bring your business here, or they don't want to bring their business here, because if you have a bad day or an off day, you're going to get a rating, and that rating is going to turn away business. I mean, right now, we're looking to those businesses to come in, and with the loss of large businesses, I think we're starting to look to these smaller business restaurants. I'm not sure that's the greatest way of doing it. Maybe there can be another way of getting with the health department and maybe beefing that up, but I'm not sure the ABC rating is the way to go. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Mr. Santiana, you mentioned in the Times Record News that the police and fire departments need serious consideration to adequately support and equip them so that they can best preserve public safety. In what areas do you want the police and the fire departments to be additionally supported and equipped?
When it comes to our police and our fire department, a lot of things have come to light in the last 6 years. I've got to work hand in hand with them. Before, I didn't, and you depend on those people to protect you. I think our basic rights in government and duties are to protect our citizens, and at municipal level, that's your firemen and that's your police. I like feeling safe in my community. I feel safe in my community. I think that we do a wonderful job. I just think that without the proper training, I mean, training is the biggest part. People are a step ahead all the time. We've learned that serving on the board of Crime Stoppers, you learn that, you know, criminals are quick and they're always a step ahead. You want to put our officers and our firemen in the best equipment available. I know it comes down once again to funding. You know, every year we have line item budget and we have to fund those people. But I think that there has to be serious consideration to what you do for our fire department and our police department. They do a wonderful job now what they have, and I've talked to them. I've sat down with both of them, and they, you know, they'll tell you they do the best they can with what they can. We're losing good officers. We're losing good firemen, and I think right now they do a wonderful job. Thank you.
All right. Mr. King, rebuttal.
On our city budget right now, the biggest expenditure we have is labor. The labor force of Wichita Falls. Out of all the departments, the police department is paid the highest amount in labor cost. Fire department is second. I do not begrudge the police officers all the money they can get. My son is a police officer in Dallas, Texas. But we have to understand we have a budget and we have to live within it. We can't just keep spending money.
Okay, thank you. All right, Mr. King. In the voter guide, you have suggested that one of the priorities of the city should be making hard choices and eliminating waste. What would you talk about the examples of waste in the current city administration?
Current waste. Last spring, the city council approved a contract for mowing the state highways within the city limits of Wichita Falls. This is the state's responsibility. I don't remember exactly how much the contract was for, but it was unnecessary. The state was going to mow the Kell West, Kell East, I-44 Iowa Park Road, but the city took this over. That was not necessary. Another example, they bought motorcycles for the police officers. They did not take lowest bidder. They took BMW motorcycles. We have no BMW dealership in Wichita Falls. So any warranty work or service work, I assume, has to be sent to Dallas-Fort Worth to fix these motorcycles.
Mr. Santiana, rebuttal?
I agree with them on the mowing portion. TxDOT is responsible for the state highways, and they have a budget, and they have, you know, way larger than Wichita Falls, and they have the means to let those maintenance contracts out, and they do. I mean, monthly they do. They let those maintenance contracts out. So that is a little bit of fluff, a little bit of waste on the city side. As far as the PD and their motorcycles, we want to put those – low bid is not always winner. And I can tell you that because I bid on a lot of contracts and I bid on a lot of equipment. And sometimes you have to take what's best, not what's cheapest. If I'm going to put officers that are in charge of protecting our community and my children, I think I want to put them on the best equipment possible. And I think the council – and the leadership had to have taken consideration where those motorcycles are going to get serviced and whether or not they're going to be serviced here locally or serviced out of town. I would think that anybody would want our officers to be on the best equipment possible, not the cheapest. Thank you.
All right. Okay. Now our questions are going to go to District 2. Mr. Milton, in the voter guide, you stated that the city should provide economic incentives for the growth of local industries to the same extent as incentives have been provided for external industries. What specific incentives do you have in mind for local industries?
I would love to see the city help the businesses that we have already that want to add on new jobs and can provide new jobs, to give them some incentives as far as maybe some 4A funds or tax relief on it. We take in businesses from out of town that we don't know anything about, and we give them millions of dollars. And we've had, I think, two just belly up on us. I would love to take and invest some of that money to the local people that's trying to do the same thing, that has a proven record, that we know has got a proven record, and can help them to build their business and build this city. I would much rather see us help 10 smaller businesses gain 15 to 20 employees than give to one major company that comes in and promises 100 jobs and fails.
All right, thank you. Ms. Chenault, rebuttal?
I agree with Mr. Milton as far as helping the small businesses that we have here in town, but as far as like the economic growth and the businesses that are coming to Wichita Falls that are new, I feel like the residents of Wichita Falls should benefit. They should be able to be employed at these businesses that are coming into our city.
All right. Ms. Chenault, in the voter guide, you said that you believe that more community resources need to be available for District 2. What resources do you believe need to be directed to District 2?
I work at Downtown Pharmacy, and I deal with people all day. And we have people that come in that need so many needs, and a lot of people that come into my job live in District 2. I always have a list of agencies here, like Interfaith, Salvation Army, different places like that that can assist people that are in need.
Mr. Milton, rebuttal?
Would you repeat the question one more time?
Well, yes, specific needs of District 2, what resources?
Okay, the specific needs is we need to come up with some kind of plan that will actually help District 2 grow and benefit the people of District 2. We need some programs to help with the growth on the east side and throughout District 2. And it's just going to take some thought process, and it's going to take the community and the council getting together and coming up with solutions to these.
All right, thank you. All right, Mr. Milton, in the voter guide, you mentioned that we need to reduce overreaching regulation of downtown In the voter guide, you mentioned that we need to reduce overreaching regulation and bureaucratic hurdles for our hometown business owners. What would you address these changes that you would like to see?
I would love to see a committee get together that could get with the people that's trying to revitalize the downtown area and the city and come up with some solutions that we could kind of expedite the permit process to where people can build downtown and make it financially feasible for them without going to such extremes as having to add sprinkler systems to something, or if we can do something with a wall to make it better to do the job, where we can do it cheaper, to where we can get more businesses going down there and revitalize the downtown area and just be a friendlier city to the contractors.
Okay. Ms. Chenault, rebuttal?
As far as revising the downtown area, I feel like if the city would bring in some jobs in the downtown area, that would help to get some residents of the city of Wichita Falls employed. I work downtown, and there are plenty of vacant buildings that can be restored where businesses can come in and where that area can grow.
All right. Ms. Chenault, this is on revitalization. In the Times Record News, you stated that you believe that the revitalization of downtown should be a top priority. What do you believe that should be done in the downtown area that is not already being done?
I feel like that the vacant buildings downtown, I know there is some kind of way that there can be some businesses brought in downtown. My biggest thing is, just because I work there and there's no businesses there, and my boss always, he talks to me all the time about, you know, hey, you know, why they don't bring any businesses down here, you know, and we talk about it all the time, but I'm not really sure what the city can do. I know Downtown Pride has done everything that they can right now.
Okay. Mr. Melton, rebuttal?
I feel like there's a whole lot we can do in the downtown area. We have some real good buildings downtown that need some work, and if we could get the city to go in with the downtown development group and come up with some plans where we could put some money into some of these buildings. We could have an entertainment area downtown like Oklahoma City or Austin. We could have antique stores like many of the towns are having, which we're starting to get antique stores and stuff downtown. And the larger buildings we got would be fantastic for offices and everything else, but it's going to take people with a vision for the downtown area. The trouble is, the people with a vision for downtown area, they're either wanting to do the historic stuff, which is great, but we also need businesses also.
All right. Thank you. Now, each candidate will get 1 minute for a closing statement to say anything you want, and we will go left to right again. So we'll start with Mr. Smith.
I want to thank the League of Women Voters and others, the city, for providing this opportunity for the candidates to come before the public. I would say that in my race for city councilor at large, my experience in administration and finance and evaluation of programs and dealing with people from every walk of life, and the experience I've gained by serving for 8 years as District 1 Counselor, Mayor Pro Tem, Counselor at Large, and now running again for Counselor at Large, would make me someone to really look at for your vote. And I'm challenging all citizens to vote. You know, the last few elections we have had a very small turnout, and I know we've got some big items on our election this coming May 9th. So please look at the issues, look at the candidates, make your decision, and please, please go vote.
All right, thank you. Ms. James?
I want to thank everyone who came tonight and the League of Women Voters for hosting this forum. And I want to encourage everyone to get out and vote. Without your vote, you have no voice. And we want to hear from all of you.
All right, thank you. Mr. Santayana?
Once again, I want to thank everybody for being here. And thank you, League of Women Voters, for doing this for the city of Wichita Falls. For District 1, I would think I'm the best choice. I think that voters need to go out and look at what I've done for our community, my civic involvement, my financial background, business sense, and education. If you couple those together and put that with my true love for the city and for being a part of the city and wanting to be part of the city in the future, I think it can be a clear choice that I would be a great counselor for District 1. I think that the choices that we make today in choosing our counselors is a tough one. Like Counselor Smith said, I don't think there's enough people right now going out there and making those choices. And the low voter turnout is disappointing, and I think things like this bring a lot more voters out, and hopefully when those voters come out to vote, they make the right decision. Thank you.
Right. Mr. King.
I
All right. Mr. Melton.
I'd like to thank the League of Women's Voters and the citizens also for putting up with us. I feel like I'm the most qualified candidate for this year because of the years of experience I've got in business and finances. And I would love to serve the other people in District 2. And I will promise that I'll work for each and every person in the district, not just one special interest group. I would like to just tell everybody to please go out and vote. If you don't vote, you don't have no reason to complain. Whoever you vote for, just study it and make the right decision. Thank you.
Ms. Chenault.
I'd like to thank the League of Women Voters for inviting me out tonight. I also would like everyone in the audience, thank you for coming out tonight. I believe in my community. I believe that if we work together, that we can make a change, and it takes all of us to make a difference. I encourage everyone to please go out and vote, and early vote this week and next week. And remember, vote Chenault. Thank you.
Okay, we'd like to thank the candidates for coming, the audience, and a special thank you to the city for letting us use these facilities and for taping and playing back this tape. By the way, this will be on Tuesday, starting tomorrow, the 28th, at Monday at 7 o'clock and 7 o'clock at night. And it will run that way until May the 4th. And then on May the 4th to May the 8th, it will be on at 7 in the morning and 10 o'clock at night. Now, that's on the cable vision station. On the city council station, it's available anytime after tomorrow. We also want to remind you that we have voters' guides up here, and early voting has started, and the candidates are going to be available, what did we say, down the hallway for to answer any questions if anybody has any. Thank you, guys.
I've got about